So, last time we learned the while character formula, and so it gives us some kind of formula for the character of an irreducible representation of highest weight mu. But today we want to use it to compute the dimension of an irreducible representation. So that's about this. That's what this section is about, and it's called the Weil dimension formula. So, so we have a finite dimensional irreducible representation of a semi-simple Lie algebra G with highest weight mu as usual. And our goal today is to derive a formula for the dimension of this representation using the Weil character formula. So what is that? So Weil character formula, Weil character formula that we learned last time says that the character evaluated at h, this is equal to this given as a ratio of two sums like this, e to the mu plus delta h summation this Weil denominator . So this is the Weil character formula. And we already know that the dimension of V mu is equal to the character evaluated at zero matrix or zero element, right? So it looks pretty trivial. I mean, we already have a formula. Why don't we just plug in H equals zero? We will get a formula for the dimension. But the problem is, the situation is not that simple, because if you plug in t equals 0, h equals 0 here, the denominator is 0. So we have something like 0 over 0, which is not defined. So we have to deal with this situation. We cannot plug in just simply h equals 0. So if here, this is 0 if h equals 0. If this is 0, you know, this term just goes away, and you sum over all these alternating determinants, then it's going to be 0. So we cannot simply plug in. So we have to do something else, but let's consider this simple situation where we have this SL2 with irreducible representation with highest weight mu equals m. We know already this. We already computed the character. In this case, this equals sine h m plus 1 a over sine h a. Of course, this, if you try to plug in a equals 0, you see sine h of 0 is 0. So we cannot do that. But this character is a continuous function. It is a trace of exponential function, so it's continuous. So this must be equal to a approaches 0 of this, right? But now everything is just calculus. We have limit 0 over 0 form, so we can use L'Hopital's rule to evaluate this. Then this is going to be by L'Hopital's rule. You take the ratio of their derivatives, so it's going to be, the denominator will be cosine h a. This derivative with respect to a, we get by the chain rule m plus 1. But now we can plug in a equals 0, they both become 1, so it's going to be m plus 1, which is really the dimension of this, right? So even though we cannot just plug in a 0 there, we can somehow use property like a continuity of the character, and then we can somehow use L'Hopital's rule to evaluate the dimension. Today's goal is to do something similar to this, to this general situation. So we want to develop a kind of L'Hopital's rule in this case, which is pretty interesting, so I'll try to go over the proof today. By the way, the theorem looks like this. Eventually, we will be able to prove this. So suppose that we have this irreducible representation with highest weight mu, okay? Then the dimension, this is the Weyl dimension formula. This is given by this ratio product over all positive root, alpha inner product with delta, mu plus delta, over alpha r plus alpha delta. This is the formula. This is the Weyl dimension formula. It's a very nice application of the Weyl character formula. Notice that the denominator is non-zero because delta, what is delta? Do you remember? Delta is half the sum of the positive roots, and we already know that it's greater than zero. So it's always positive, so never zero. So it always makes sense. Also here is strictly dominant, both are strictly dominant, so it's not zero. The dimension should not be zero, right? So our approach is to find, so our approach, strategy, find a kind of L'Hopital's rule. But we have to develop some setting. So first, definition. Now, suppose that we have a function from the Cartan subalgebra to this complex number. This function is called a polynomial. So this is a definition. If for every basis, say H1 dot 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 HR, of course, basis of this Cartan subalgebra, F is a polynomial in the coordinate. In other words, i.e., so what does that mean? So element here can always be written uniquely as a linear sum of this, right? So we have everything here should be written uniquely in this way because now we have fixed the basis. And then this it means this is a polynomial in these coefficients z1, z2, zr. So it should be written as a polynomial of this, like a z1 squared, z3 plus something like that. Okay? If it can be written that way, then you say that it's a polynomial. But note that simple fact, which you can check, if because here the definition says that's for every basis, but you don't have to check for every basis. If it works for just one fixed basis, it will work for everything else. So if f is a polynomial function in one variable, like this, one basis, then it is a polynomial function for any other basis. So if it works for one basis, it's okay. Because, you know, if you have one basis, you can express this in terms of another basis using the change of basis matrix, but that changes is just a linear. So you can, if you combine them together, you can get another polynomial expression for the other basis. So that's the idea. So this is this will be an important concept in today. So now we can talk about polynomial functions of for a function from Cartan subalgebra to C. But you know, this, if you see a function like this, it looks a little looks difficult. It's, what is that? It's a vector space to something. But you know, once you fix the basis, it is basically a multinomial, a multivariate function, right? Once you fix this, this is merely just, multivariate function, something like, Z. This is really a multivariate. You can think of this as multivariate function, right? Once you fix the basis, because, multivariate, these are the variables. And it is called, multivariate function is called a polynomial if it is a polynomial in those variables. That's exactly what this means. Just think of it that way. You fix a basis, then it's a polynomial. All right. So for a polynomial, we can talk about this. A polynomial, F, is homogeneous if of degree L, if F C times H equals C to the L F H for all constant C and all elements in the Cartan subalgebra. But this is really the same thing as what we normally say for homogeneous polynomials. Homogeneous means every term has the same degree, like x1 squared, x2, maybe we have something like that, x1, x2, x3, something like that. This is a polynomial of degree 3 and homogeneous because every term has total degree 3. But of course, if you replace each xi by cxi, you get c to the 3, right? So it's homogeneous, that's exactly what this is saying. Once you know that it's a polynomial, and if it satisfies this, then it's homogeneous of degree L. And every term must have the same degree L. So for instance, if F X equals X1, X2, X3, then F of CX is C to the 3 FX. Homogeneous of degree 3. Okay. Throughout this lecture, we're going to be using this notation. Define a special function from H to C by this formula. P of H equals product all positive roots alpha in a product with H. So once you fix one element here, you will get a complex number because it's a product of complex numbers. It's a very particular function. By the way, if you define a function like that, then it's going to be a polynomial in our definition. Because notice that every factor here, this is a function, because if you alpha is fixed, if you plug in h, then you get a number. So it's a function, but it's a linear function. This is a linear function. In z1 dot 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 zr, if we write, of course, if h equals summation h ZiHi, once we fix the basis element, right? Because this is really simple. You know, this is linear, so it's summation over R H I and Z I. So this is a constant, right? This is think of this as a variable. So it's linear, homogeneous, linear function. So you, if you take the product of homogeneous polynomials, then the result will be will also be a homogeneous polynomial. And the degree add up. So the so P H, just P say. So this is a homogeneous polynomial of what's the degree? K, which is, of course, the number of positive roots. So we will denote the number of positive roots by K from now on, okay? So K is the number of positive roots. Now we define this this thing. Then what is the Weyl character formula or Weyl dimension formula? Using this, let's write. Okay, maybe next page, or right here. Okay, then Weyl dimension formula is equivalent to this or the same. Dimension of V mu equals P. Mu plus delta over P delta. Because I just rewrote using this function. If you plug in here delta, mu plus delta, then if you remember, that's exactly the numerator of the Weyl dimension formula. And if you plug in H equals delta, then that's exactly the denominator of the Weyl character, Weyl dimension formula. Look at this, right? This is exactly P. With this one, this is P with delta. Okay, it's really the same thing. So we will prove this. Before that, we of course we have to develop some more theory and definition. So suppose that we have a function from Cartan subalgebra to a complex number. This is this is Weyl alternating. We say that's Weyl alternating if you apply W inside this. This is equal to the determinant and H for all Weyl group elements and elements in the Cartan subalgebra. Okay. This will be an important concept in our class today. So recall from homework, you just did it today or yesterday. The Weyl denominator, which we denote by a Q, the definition was this, right? Determinant of W E. This is Weyl alternating, right? Did you do that? That means if you apply W inside, then it's the same thing as multiplying determinant. So Weyl denominator is a typical example of a Weyl alternating function. Okay. So we will prove the following proposition. Proposition 10.21. First, P, the function that I just defined, P is Weyl alternating. Let me just write that way. Second, if F is Weyl alternating, then there exists a polynomial G such that f x equals g h p h for all h. In other words, f is p times g for a polynomial. So i.e., in other words, just simply f is g times a p. Why can't we see over there? Okay, we don't have enough space today. That's very unfortunate because I'm going to use a lot of things today. But anyway, not that bad. You can see that. File alternating. Alright. This is somehow similar to the situation like that. Suppose that you have just a polynomial in variables x1 up to xn. But let's do that over here. Suppose x1 dot 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 xn the polynomial such that f usually is called anti-symmetric. This means it's really W acts on x because dimension right? If you permute the variables, then you get the sign, right? In this case, we say that it's anti-symmetric. If it's really the same without the sign, then it's called a symmetric, right? But the fact is, if f is anti-symmetric polynomial, then f is divisible by delta, where this is a polynomial, and this is like Vandermonde determinant, xi minus xj, I less than j. You may have seen something like this. So actually, this is a Vandermonde determinant. So what we are going to prove is something similar to this. Okay. So this is a very basic fact. All right. So just try to compare that with anti-symmetric function. So the proof. First, since W, what does that mean? This means P W H equals determinant of W P of H, right? We want to show that. But this is generated by what? Simple reflection, or the reflections associated to the simple root, right? It's generated by this, meaning that every element is a product of this. And what is the determinant of the product of several reflections? Yeah, determinant is a homomorphism? No, it separates. But for each of these, it's a reflection, so its determinant is going to be minus 1. So it will be always minus 1 to the L. Okay? Because everything here is a reflection. So, enough to show that just what happens if you apply just one reflection for a simple root alpha, then we must get H, right? For alpha and all alpha and H. It's enough to show this. We will prove this. Okay? So how can we do that? Let's just see, just using the definition. The definition says that this is the product over all positive roots, say beta. So alpha is a fixed simple root. We have like beta times inner product with this vector. Okay? But we've already done this kind of technique. This is inner product, and this is a reflection, or in particular, it's an orthogonal transformation. So we can move this to the other side with inverse. But it's a reflection, its inverse is the same as itself. So S alpha, inverse or doesn't matter, it's the same thing, right? Because it's orthogonal, it preserves the inner product. So, but what is this? If you have a good memory, you will remember that we have positive roots, and if you apply a simple reflection, we get almost all positive roots except one, right? So in recall from proposition 8.30, S alpha permutes all the positive roots except alpha. So it sends this set to itself. Of course, it will be permuted, but in total, they will be the same. And what is S alpha applied to alpha? It's minus, it reflects alpha. Okay? So we know exactly what this is. So we, for all of this, so then this is going to be equal to, for all beta r plus minus alpha, except alpha, it's the same, just like beta h. You don't have to use this because it's just a permutation of the products, it's the same. And for the remaining one, we will get minus alpha h. But of course, minus alpha, we can put this outside. And this alpha combines here, into, we can get all the positive roots, so it's going to be minus all the positive roots, which is exactly minus ph. So that's the proof of the first item. Okay, the second one, we have to prove the second one. So proof of the second one. The second, let me rewrite this. F is by alternating. Then F is G times P. G is polynomial. Let's prove that. Okay. So for all positive root, what happens if H is orthogonal to alpha, then this means FH must be zero. Why is that? Orthogonal means, what does that mean? So alpha is here, so you have a considered hyperplane orthogonal to alpha. H lives in this hyperplane. That means if you apply S alpha to it, it doesn't change. F H is equal to F S alpha H. Because H is equal to H alpha, S alpha H. Because it's orthogonal to alpha. But by the assumption that this is while alternating, this is going to be equal to minus F H. But F H equals minus F H, FH must be 0, okay? So let's use this notation, which we used several times. So V sub alpha for root alpha is the hyperplane orthogonal to alpha. Okay, so this is a hyperplane orthogonal to alpha. In fact, there is a fact that we are going to use, and it's actually one of the homework problem. Fact says that if f is a polynomial such that f vanishes at alpha, all space here as a function here, then fh we must be able to write this like that for some polynomial g. Yogyo? Ah, 그쵸, 그쵸. 네, 맞습니다. 네, 정의가 안 되죠, 이렇게 하면. 하이퍼플레인 오소고널 투 알파. 액츄얼리 this is somehow similar to the proof of proof of this. How do we prove this? If you plug in xi equals xj, we get zero. That means it must, as a polynomial, it must have the factor xi minus xj. So in this way, we just show that it has to have all these factors. It's somehow similar to that argument. So the fact says that if this polynomial vanishes on this hyperplane, it must have this factor. Okay? So using this fact, we have this. So this is a fact. So by the fact, we can write fh equals alpha h f1h for some polynomial h1. F1. Okay? Now we will try to factor this again with a different alpha. So now let's take another simple root. Not simple. Except alpha. And we want to show that it also, this polynomial also has the factor beta comma h. Then by the same argument, f restricted to this is going to be zero by the factor over here. Basically it means that f restricted v alpha equals zero, right? Whenever you have a positive root, f vanishes on the hyperplane orthogonal to it. Okay. But we want to show that this vanishes on this hyperplane. Okay? To do that, if h is hyperplane orthogonal to beta except those orthogonal to alpha, then we can say that f because this is not here, h alpha is non-zero. Okay? Because it's outside of this orthogonal hyperplane. Therefore, this part is going to be is zero, right? Because h is in v beta. This part is zero, but this part is not zero. That means f1h is zero, right? Because one of them must be zero. That means f1 restricted to say v beta minus v alpha is zero. But this is not quite what we are looking for. We want to show that f1 vanishes on the whole V beta, not some part of that. However, but what is this? V beta minus V beta intersect V alpha, just right? So from this space, we subtract this part. But what is the dimension of this? What is the dimension here? Dimension of this? R minus 1. So R is the dimension of the whole space, right? Hyperplane is dimension, we have one less than the whole space. What is the dimension here? Notice that V beta is different from V alpha, because alpha beta are not the same vector. So we have one hyperplane, we have another one intersection, then we will have dimension R minus 2. So its dimension is strictly less than that. So we have some kind of situation like this is V alpha beta, and intersection is something like that. So dimension is, we have some part that's not inside V beta, but that portion is very, very small. The dimension is less than that. That means it's measure zero, or in other words, dense. That means V beta minus V alpha is dense in the space. Like this part is almost all the space. So this function, polynomial, vanishes on this dense subset, then it must vanish all the whole space because it's continuous. F1 is continuous. Polynomial is a continuous function. It must be zero for all. Because we only know that the polynomial vanishes here, but why is that vanish over here? Because we can kind of find a sequence approaching to this point. They're all zero, so by continuity, it's going to be zero. That means, this means by the fact again, F1. F1 is equal to beta H dot F2 for some polynomial F2. Now you see that you can continue doing this, and then you can use all the remaining positive roots, repeating this way. We conclude this second point. We can show that all the factors there really exist there. Okay, so we prove this proposition. Now we have to prove another lemma, which also uses another definition. So, for any element in the Cartan subalgebra, the differential of operator d alpha is defined by the following formula. So it's really the directional derivative, if you know this calculus. T equals zero. So IE is a directional derivative. So it sends a function from H to C to another function, H to C, so it's an operator on the function spaces. It sends function f to d alpha f like that. So it's exactly the directional derivative. Okay? then lemma, which is which will be used in the proof of the viral dimension formula. Let's use denote A to be the product of this d alpha for all positive roots. So it's basically a composition of directional derivatives, right? You compose these directional derivatives. You first take the directional derivative in this way, direction, and then this direction, all possible direction from the positive roots. And for lambda, we also define F lambda by this formula. So actually, this is like the formula in the viral character formula. The numerator and denominator can also be written that way. Then we have these three things. First, F lambda is viral alternating. And second, F lambda H is equal to some constant times P, or the special function F at P, and plus terms of degree greater than or equal to K plus 1 as a power series. As a power series, what does that mean? Again, express H as a linear sum of basis, and then we have coefficients z1, z2, dot, 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 and then this can be written as a formal power series or a power series of these variables x1, x2, z1, z2, zr. Where here this is constant, and third, we know exactly what this constant is. This is like this operator applied to H, evaluated. Applied to F lambda, evaluate at zero, and AP evaluate at zero, where we have this non-zero denominator, and the numerator, in fact, has a different expression, like the product, the number of phi group elements times P evaluated at lambda. It's quite a long statement. But by the way, this part, the first part is easy. It's like just like a homework problem. You prove this for viral denominator, but the same argument works for this. So the first one is easy. Second one, is a little more difficult, and the third one is more difficult. Okay, let's prove. So first one is easy, so I'm gonna omit it. Second, let's fix the basis. H1 dot 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 HR is the basis of H. And let's write H as a linear sum of them, ZIHI, okay, like that. Then, what is F? F lambda H is equal to sum over all phi group elements, determinant. I'm just writing using the definition. Where is it? Over here. And replace this by this. Right? But what is that? Is it summation, determinant, E, let's write it this way, product I from 1 to r, it's I from 1 to r, e to the, because this sum becomes product. Let's write this way. H I z I. So it's really an exponential function, which can be written as a power series. So it is really a power series in those variables, z1, z2, dot, 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 zr, written in this way. Okay. So f lambda h is a convergent, especially convergent. E exponential function is always convergent. Convergent power series in z1, dot, 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 zr. Move on to the next page. So everything okay so far? Our strategy is to decompose them into homogeneous components. So let okay over here. Let F lambda L be the how can I say? Homogeneous component of F lambda of degree L. Because it's a power series, if you look at every term, it is a monomial. It is a monomial of some degree. So you just collect those monomials of degree L, then you will get a homogeneous component, which is a polynomial, homogeneous polynomial of degree L. Then, by another homework, exercise 5, at the first place, we know that F itself is alternating, and each component, homogeneous component, is also while alternating. So we have a polynomial while alternating. Actually, I think I forgot to mention, but let's go back to this theorem. Where is it? Over here. There's an important consequence of this second item. This, if F is a polynomial which is while alternating, it must be factored into this. But this is a polynomial. What is the degree of this? Degree is k, the number of positive roots. So if the polynomial here has degree less than k, how can we have this equation? It must be zero. If the degree of h is less than k, the only way that this is satisfied is that g is zero, so that f is zero. So a consequence here is that let's write it over here. Let me delete some part. Consequence, I forgot to mention. If degree of f is less than k, which is the number of positive roots, and f is while alternating, then f must be identically zero, which is. And if the dimension is the same as k and f is while alternating, then what can we say? This has degree k, this has degree k, this must be a constant, because otherwise we will have a bigger degree polynomial. F must be constant times p, where c is some constant. So we will use this fact, which is a simple consequence of this. Okay. All right. Sorry about this. Now we are back to here. We have power series, which is while alternating, we separate or decompose it into homogeneous components, which are also while alternating, and they are polynomials now. So, if L is the degree of this polynomial, so if L is less than K, then this has to be zero, like I mentioned, right? And what happens if L equals K? F is constant, C, say C lambda, P, for some C lambda, depending on A or K, let's try K. Okay? That means F lambda is really the first non-zero term of the, in terms of the degree is this, and then terms of higher degree, K plus 1, right? This is exactly, this is 2. As a power series, it can be written in this way. Now we have to prove the third item. I'm going to do that in the next page. Let me rewrite the statement. So A is product of this, right? All the directional derivatives. And the statement 3 says that C lambda, the coefficient that we found over here, the coefficient must be equal to AF lambda evaluated as 0 over AP evaluated as 0, and this must be non-negative or non-zero, and this is the numerator can be written in this way. Okay, we will prove this. Proof. The proof, we use a little bit of calculus. By the way, we know that this is a derivative. If we have a polynomial of degree S, if G is a polynomial of degree S, if you apply this operator, then we will lose degree by 1. Then degree of this operator applied to G must be S minus 1. It's like, you know, x to the n, if you take the derivative, we get x to the n minus 1 times some constant. It's true for all directional derivatives. So basic calculus. So, okay, so 2 says that F lambda H equals C lambda P H plus terms of degree greater than or equal to K plus 1, right? The degree of this is K. Degree of terms here greater than K. Now taking the operator A on both sides of 2, then let's see what happens. A F lambda H equals A, maybe less, because C alpha is a constant, C lambda is a constant, plus, okay, let's write it this way, A applied to terms of degree greater than or equal to K plus 1. And let's see what happens. A is a composition of k differential operators. So it will decrease the degree by k, because once you apply one operator, you lose degree by one. So here, okay, what is the degree of this degree? The original polynomial has degree k, so now it will be degree 0. So what about here? This operator is linear, so it applies to each term, so it kills the degree by k. So it's terms of degree greater than 1. So what happens if we plug in h equals 0? So what happens if we apply, then something 0, right? But what happens if you plug in 0 over here? It's 0. Because everything has at least one of the z's. We have terms looks like z1 plus z2, I don't know, something like that. Each term, because h equals zero means each zi is 0. So it's everything just goes to 0. Because every term has at least one z. So this is good, because it is almost like that. All we need to do is to divide C alpha both sides by this. Then we will get this formula. But of course, we have to show that this is non-zero. Now what? Let's see. Let's compute this. Let's see what happens over here. It's going to be determinant or bigroup element. This is the definition. Right? This is the definition of AF, and I just applied the differential operator over here because it's just constant. But the thing is, here, this part is equal to e to the okay, W lambda H W lambda alpha. This is the claim. Proof of claim. Okay, let me write it in general situation. So claim, if you apply d alpha to e to the some mu comma h, so for this can be rewritten as mu, and this is going to be equal to e to the mu h mu alpha. Proof. This is just a basic calculus. This part is left-hand side d dt e to the mu h plus t alpha, and this at t equals 0. This is a directional derivative. And now we can use the chain rule here. So this is a one variable function. Mu, h, alpha, they are all fixed. So we just use the t alpha, and then by the chain rule, we have to multiply this derivative of this with respect to t, which is mu alpha. And then we have to plug in t equals 0. That is exactly this part over here, because if t equals 0, this goes away, and then we get this. So it's just simple stuff coming from the definition. So this is true. We know how to express this like that. So that means A, F, lambda. What if we plug in A equals 0? So this is going to be this using this. Now we can replace this by this. alpha r plus e to the, but you know, this is, if h equals 0, this is, the whole thing is 1, constant, so you can forget about it. So it's going to be w lambda alpha. But isn't this somehow familiar with you? This is exactly this part. It's p of w lambda, right? Because this part is fixed like this. But do you know, do you remember any property of p? It's while alternating, that means you can move this outside and then you will get determinant, that means you can delete this too. So for every w, you just add p of lambda, which is independent of w, that means this is w times p lambda, which is the, this part over here, which is good. But now, from there, let's compare over here. C, this part is this, so C lambda AP0 is equal to this. Okay? So we are left with this fact, to proving this. We want to show that this is non-zero. We want to show that this is non-zero. How can we show that? This, sometimes it can be zero, but you can select lambda so that this is non-zero, right? We can always select lambda in maybe in a open vial chamber, any open vial chamber, so that that means p lambda is non-zero. P lambda equals 0 means, what is the definition? It's a product of the inner product alpha times alpha comma lambda. So if lambda is perpendicular to one of the alphas, then it'll be 0, but we can always find alpha, or we can always find lambda, so that it's not in any hyperplane orthogonal to any root vectors. That means we can select lambda so that this is non-zero. So we may assume that this is non-zero. This must be non-zero, because if it is zero, then it will always be zero. So this means that AP of zero is non-zero. It is independent of lambda. And that's the proof. And that's the end of the proof of this lemma. Now we developed all the techniques we needed to prove the Weyl dimension formula. So finally, we can prove the theorem. Weyl dimension formula. I already stated, but let me rewrite it. Irreducible representation of G with highest weight mu. And then dimension is going to be equal to product alpha r plus over product alpha r plus, or in other words, is p of mu plus delta in our terminology. It's the same thing, right? We want to show this proof. Now that we've developed all the techniques, the proof is quite simple. By the Weyl character formula and the previous lemma, for all real number t and for all h, we have th is equal to, this is the Weyl, yeah, I'm not sure if I wrote this, but if you remember the definition of Well, formula for Weyl character formula and the definition of F is exactly like that. It's just a definition. T. And this is the Weyl character formula. By the way, this is the Weyl character formula. And this is lemma, it's over here. We wrote F in terms of power series. Then it's going to be C mu plus delta for some constant that we know. P of H. Because this is a homogeneous polynomial of degree K, so we can pull K outside. Plus terms of higher degree than T plus 1, which is usually denoted like that, big O notation. This means terms of degree greater than or equal to K plus 1. There's a common notation for that. And C delta, similarly, again, some power series of degrees greater than or equal to, each term has degree greater than or equal to K plus 1. But now, let's divide both sides by t to the k. Then we get but now, the degree will be decreased by k, so it's going to be big O of t. Big O of t, right? If the denominator, of course, Weyl dimension character, Weyl character formula says that, assumes that the denominator is non-zero. If the denominator is zero, then Weyl character formula does not say anything. If the denominator non-zero. Sometimes the denominator could be zero, but in that case, we cannot use that. We assume that the denominator is non-zero. But now, since we know that C lambda from the previous lemma, this times P lambda over AP 0. We have non-zero. The denominator here is non-zero. Of course, this is non-zero. Why is this non-zero? For lambda equals delta or mu plus delta, because they are strictly dominant. Strictly dominant, so every factor in this polynomial is positive, so it's non-zero. So it's non-zero for this. So we can select. So this is non-zero, this is non-zero. We can select, we can also select H so that this is non-zero. Right? We already did this in the proof of the previous lemma. We may assume that H is P of H is non-zero. So this is non-zero. This part is non-zero. This part is non-zero, right? We can select H that way. Just select H that way. But now we want this to be non-zero, but this is a fixed number now. H is fixed. If you select t very small, then this will be smaller than this. The absolute value of this will be smaller than this. That means we can make this non-zero. So then, for sufficiently small t, the denominator is non-zero. This part will be non-zero. If t is very small, now, finally, we can use the continuity of this, since this, what is the definition of this? This is the trace of e to the pi of h. This is continuous function. Exponential function is continuous, trace is continuous. We have dimension is t approaches 0, it's a continuous function. If t is very close to 0, then this formula makes sense. So the limit makes sense. And the limit must be equal to the character evaluate as zero because character is continuous. And what is this? When, if t approaches zero, this part will be zero. This part will be zero. We are only left with this. We can cancel p, p, then now we get c, only c, right? But we already know that c can be written, where is it? Over here. C can be written in this way. This is constant with respect to lambda. Okay, let's rewrite that. You know, where is it? Here. We know that C lambda equals over AP0, right? By the lemma. So if you plug in it over there, this will cancel. This will cancel. So we only left with this, which is what we wanted over here. And that's the end of the proof. We have only 4 minutes left, so I have an example to show you, but maybe I think I should do this tomorrow or Thursday. I mean, in this case, using file dimension formula, let me just state it. I'm gonna go over this in the next lecture. So mu1, mu2, fundamental weight. Then we can consider the irreducible representation with highest weight mu. Then what is the dimension of that irreducible representation? And that is written, can be written in this way. Because the Weyl dimension formula, the dimension is what? Alpha in the product over all positive roots, alpha mu plus delta, alpha delta. But what is that? If you remember, it's alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, if you write this way. So these are the positive roots, right? And fundamental weight, what is the definition of a fundamental weight? Yeah, we will do that next time. Okay? So this is a nice example of application of the Weyl dimension formula, and as some homework problems, you will do something similar to this. Okay, so I will finish this lecture. Thank you for your attention.